सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
वेद वेद्ये परे पुंसे वेद वेद्ये परे पुंसे जाते दशरथात्मजे जाते दशरथात्मजे
Namaste, Suswagatam, welcome and salutations to all. In the previous lecture, we saw that Hanuman Nataka is a compilation of poems from many different authors, some anonymous, across a vast collection of literary works. The rather large collection of sources that have contributed to Hanuman Nataka is testament to the universal popularity of Ramayana in classical India and the fascination of the Indian mind with this great epic. Indeed, the brilliant Kannada poet Kumaravyasa declares, Tinukidanu Paniraya Ramayanada Kavigala Bharadali. The great serpent Adishesha, carrying the entire globe on his mighty head, struggled under the heavy weight of the Ramayana poets. He says, in the preface to his own magnum opus, as the reason why he chose to compose his poetry on the other great epic, Mahabharata. In Telugu, Vishwanatha Satyanarayana won Jnanapita Award for his work Srimad Ramayana Kalpavruksha, composed over a period of 25 years, larger in size than the original epic of Valmiki. Apparently, his father Shobhanadri did not want his son becoming a poet. He wanted him to pursue a lucrative career in law instead. But as the son could not be dissuaded from his goal, the father finally relented to his wish but told him, if you have to be a poet, at least be known as a poet who wrote Ramayana. That shows the lofty status enjoyed by Ramayana in our cultural tradition. There are two known editions of Hanuman Nataka. The North Indian edition compiled by Madhusudana, a South Indian edition or Pathantara that comes from Damodara Mishra. In Madhusudana's edition, the work is organized into 10 acts, whereas in the Southern Damodara Mishra edition, it is organized into 14 acts. The 10-act edition is actually the larger of the two, consisting of 791 verses. On the other hand, the 14-act edition is smaller in size, including only 573 verses. Nevertheless, the quality of the verses in the smaller 573-verse 14-act edition is better than those in its larger counterpart, 791 verses divided into 10 acts. Before concluding the introductory portion of today's lecture, let us briefly discuss the meaning and scope of the term Nataka that appears in the title of the work Hanuman Nataka. Nataka is a type of Rupaka or Natya which may be loosely translated as play or drama. A Rupaka, which contains the word Rupa meaning form or image, is an art form that is supposed to hold a mirror unto life, in Shakespeare's words. The term Rupaka or Nataka is formally defined in the legendary sage Bharata's Natya Shastra as follows. Nana bhavopasampannam nanavasthantaratmakam Lokavrittanukaranam Natyametan Mayakritam. According to this, Natya is a theatrical art form that should depict a range of human emotions arising from a variety of situational plots. It is expected to emulate the mannerisms and dynamics of the world around us, while at the same time sublimating the soul of the audience by delivering an experience that transcends our everyday material existence. It is clear that in this most authoritative treatise, Natya Shastra, the term Natya enjoys a rather broad scope encompassing drama, verbal dialogue, dance and music all in its fold. Notwithstanding the common misconception today that Natya is pretty much the same as Nritya or dance. A Rupaka or Natya is classified into 10 types or categories based on the genre and size of the theatrical production. These 10 categories are Nataka, Prakarana, Mahanataka, Samavakara, Vyayoga, Ihamruga, Dima, Bhana, Anka, Viti and Prahasana. A Nataka or Prakarana is a play where the main characters are kings or other heroic men or women, as opposed to a Samavakara where the main characters are divine or semi-divine beings like Gandharvas for instance. A Dima is a play depicting epic conflict involving supernatural beings. In Western cinema, Lord of the Rings or Star Wars may be considered examples of a Dima. A Vyayoga is a short play involving drama and action. A Bhana is a monologue showcasing a stand-up comedian. A Anka is a one-act play involving a familiar theme. Viti is a folk play or a street show. Prahasana is a comedy. Ihamruga is a play of intrigue and fantasy involving something like a treasure hunt or a high-speed car chase and such. In general, pursuit of something elusive. Although Hanuman Nataka does not have a traditional structure of a play with a continuous progression of a story, it is called a Nataka or Mahanataka for some unknown reason. My personal take on this is that the author of this work had indeed planned to compose a full-fledged play but never got around to completing it. As we know, a play or rupaka typically tells a story through dialogue between characters and portrayal of events in a logical progression. The dialogues are interspersed with poetry as characters frequently break into verses that describe certain aspects of the story from an artistic viewpoint. This is common both in Sanskrit plays as well as those of Shakespeare and other well-known Western dramatists. The author of Hanuman Nataka, I think, decided to first assemble the collection of verses he wanted to include in his play and then supply the dialogues and event depictions to connect the different verses into a cohesive rendering of the story of Rama. As for the poems, he decided to reuse great works of poetry that he could draw upon from the literary works available at the time. He managed to put these verses together, constituting the skeletal framework of the play, but never got around to addressing the second part of the project, namely stitching the poetry together as part of a cohesively rendered story with character interactions and depiction of major events. So we are left with an assortment of fine poetry that constitute the raw material for a standard full-fledged play that never materialized. Perhaps it is incumbent upon one of us, a creative writer in this generation or the ones to follow, to complete this grand project started by an unknown author or authors in the centuries bygone. On this note, let us continue to go over the poems that touch upon the various episodes of Ramayana, starting from where we left off last time. In the upcoming section, we visit the incident of Rama's banishment to the forest. The next verse, well known from Valmiki Ramayana, describes the words of advice from Sumitra to her son Lakshmana, who decides to follow Rama and Sita into the forest. Ramam Dasharatham Vidhi Mam Vidhi Janakatmajam Ayodhyam Atavim Vidhi Gachatata Yatha Sukham. Sumitra tells Lakshmana, in this next phase of your life, think of your older brother Rama as your father Dasharatha. Regard Sita as your mother. Treat her with respect, like you would treat me. Think of the dense jungle around you as the bustling city of Ayodhya. Go follow your brother. After all, he is your destiny and the source of your happiness. In the last line, Gacchata tayatha sukham, there is a suggestion, an undercurrent or dhvani, that the desolate forest with Rama would be a happier place for Lakshmana than the city of Ayodhya without Rama. The next verse describes Dasharatha's lament.
Maam badhate nahi tatha gahaneshu vaso rajyaruchir janaka bandhava vatsalasya ramanujasya bharatasya yatha priyayah padaravinda gamana kshatirutpalakshyah.
Rama is dispassionate and does not mind giving up his kingdom. After all, his love for his brothers trumps his fascination with wealth or power. Therefore, the thought of Rama living in the forest does not bother me as much, or for that matter, the thought of his brother Lakshmana or even Bharata, as the thought of the innocent Sita with eyes of a water lily roughing it out in the jungle, with her delicate lotus feet risking injury every step of the way. Upon Rama's departure to the forest, Bharata is urgently summoned back from his uncle's place to his home city Ayodhya. He has no idea why he is being called back. People around him seem to be avoiding his questions. Finally, he sees his mother Kaikeyi, the only person who could possibly lay his concerns and fears to rest. But Kaikeyi also responds to her son's queries in a vague, cryptic manner, begging more questions on Bharata's part. This brilliant poem consists of one-liners that fly back and forth between Bharata and Kaikeyi, as Bharata finally realizes the tragedy that has transpired in Ayodhya.
Matastatah kvayatah surapati bhavanam hakutah putrashokat kosau putras chaturnam tvamavarajataya yasya jatah kimadya praptosau kananantam kimiti drupagira kim tathasau babhashe madvagbaddhah phalam te kimiha tavadharadishata hahatosmi.
Bharata: O mother, where did father go? Kaikeyi: To the abode of gods. But then Dasharatha was a frequent traveler to heaven, had been there before on many business trips, to meet and collaborate with Indra on various occasions in the past, so Kaikeyi's answer did not explain anything. So Bharata insists, Ha, kutaha, but why? Kaikeyi answers, Putra shokat, out of sadness upon the loss of his son. Now Bharata is puzzled. Kosau putras chaturnam? Which of his four sons did he lose? Kaikeyi: Tvamavarajataya yasya jataha. That one to whom you are a younger brother. Bharata is still confused. He asks, Kimadya praptosau? Where is my elder brother now? Kaikeyi: Kananantam. In the forest. At the edge of the forest. Bharata: Kimiti? What for? Kaikeyi: Rupagira. Upon the king's command. Bharata: Kim tathasau bhabhashe? Why did the king issue such a command? Kaikeyi: Madvagbaddhah. Because I made him. Bharata is incredulous. Phalante kimiha? What did you get out of it? Kaikeyi proudly: Tavadharadishata. I got you to be king. Bharata is crestfallen. Ha hatosmi. Oh shit. To be idiomatically accurate. So we have this entire multiple rounds of rapid fire conversation packed into a single verse in the Sragdara meter. Next poem is about Rama's plea to Mother Earth on behalf of Sita, who is about to follow him into the forest.
Aruna dalana linyas nigdha padaravinda
ಕಠಿಣತರ ಧರಿಣ್ಯಾ ಅತ್ಯಕಸ್ಮಾತ್ ಸ್ಖಲಂತಿ ಅವನಿತ ವಸುತೇಯಂ ಪಾದವಿನ್ಯಾಸ ದೇಶೇ ತ್ಯಜ ನಿಜ ಕಠಿಣತ್ವಂ ಜಾನಕೀಯತ್ಯರಣ್ಯಂ. ಓ ಮದರ್ ಅರ್ಥ್, ಯುವರ್ ಡಾಟರ್ ಸೀತಾ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಟೆಪಿಂಗ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ಲಿ ಆನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಸರ್ಫೇಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಟೈಮ್. ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಹೋಲ್ಡ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ದ ನ್ಯಾಚುರಲ್ ಹಾರ್ಡ್ನೆಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುವರ್ ಟೆರೈನ್ ವೆರ್ ಎವರ್ ಶಿ ಪ್ಲೇಸಸ್ ಹರ್ ಫೀಟ್. ಸಾಫನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಟೆಂಪರರಿಲಿ ಲೈಕ್ ದ ಸಾಫ್ಟ್ ಲೋಟಸ್ ಪೆಟಲ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಫ್ಲರಿಶ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪಾಂಡ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆನ್ ಯು ಅಂಡ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಫ್ಲೋ ಓವರ್ ಯು. ದ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಪೋಯಮ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ಸ್ ಎನ್ ಇನ್ಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ ಆಸ್ ರಾಮ ಸೀತಾ ಅಂಡ್ ಲಕ್ಷ್ಮಣ ಆರ್ ವಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಥ್ರೂ ದ ಜಂಗಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆರ್ ಅಕೋಸ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಅ ಬಂಚ್ ಆಫ್ ಟ್ರೈಬಲ್ಸ್. ಪತಿ ಪಥಿಕ ವಧೂಭಿಸ್ ಸಾದರಂ ಪೃಚ್ಯಮಾಣ ಕುವಲಯ ದಲ ನೀಲ ಕೋಯಮಾರ್ಯೇ ತವೇತಿ ಸ್ಮಿತ ವಿಕಸಿತ ಗಂಡಂ ವ್ರೀಢ ವಿಭ್ರಾಂತ ನೇತ್ರಂ ಮುಖಮವನಮಯಂತಿ ಸ್ಪಷ್ಟಮಾಚಷ್ಟ ಸೀತಾ. ಆಸ್ ರಾಮ ಲಕ್ಷ್ಮಣ ಅಂಡ್ ಸೀತಾ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್ ದ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ ಸೈಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಪ್ರೋಚ್ ದ ವಿಲ್ಡರ್ನೆಸ್, ಸೀತಾ ವಾಸ್ ಮೆಟ್ ಬೈ ಎ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಆಫ್ ಟ್ರೈಬಲ್ ವಿಮೆನ್ ಹೂ ವಾಕ್ ವಿತ್ ಹರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ ಅಪ್ ಎ ಕಾನ್ವರ್ಸೇಷನ್. ವೈಲ್ ದ ಟೌನ್ ಡ್ವೆಲರ್ಸ್ ವುಡ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್ ದ ಟ್ರಯೋ, ದ ಟ್ರೈಬಲ್ ಫೋಕ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸೀನ್ ದ ರಾಯಲ್ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಎವರ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್. ಸೊ ದೇ ಆಸ್ಟ್ ಹರ್, ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಡಾರ್ಕ್ ಸ್ಕಿನ್ ಯಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸಮ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ವಾಕಿಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ಯು? ಯೆಸ್, ದಟ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಹೂಸ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ಸ್ ದ ಪೆಟಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಬ್ಲೂ ಲೋಟಸ್. ಸೀತಾ ವಿತ್ ಹರ್ ಐಸ್ ರಿವೀಲಿಂಗ್ ಎನ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ರೆಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಶಾರ್ಕ್ ಅಮ್ಯೂಸ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಶೈನೆಸ್, ಶಿ ಎನನ್ಸಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಹರ್ ಫೇಸ್ ಲೋವರ್ಡ್ ದಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಇಂಡೀಡ್ ಹರ್ ಹಸ್ಬೆಂಡ್ ರಾಮ. ಮುಖಮವನಮಯಂತಿ ಸ್ಪಷ್ಟಮಾಚಷ್ಟ ಸೀತಾ. ಇವೆಂಚುವಲಿ ದೇ ಸೆಟ್ ಅಪ್ ಎ ಹರ್ಮಿಟೇಜ್ ಇನ್ ಪಂಚವಟಿ. ದ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಶ್ಲೋಕಾಸ್ ಟಾಕ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಸೆರೀನ್ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿ ಆಫ್ ಪಂಚವಟಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಸರೌಂಡಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ಏಷಾ ಪಂಚವಟಿ ರಘುತ್ತಮ ಕುಟಿ ಯತ್ರಾಸ್ತಿ ಪಂಚಾವಟಿ ಪಾಂಥಸ್ಯೈಕ ಘಟಿ ಪುರಸ್ಕೃತ ತಟಿ ಸಂಶ್ಲೇಷ ಭಿತ್ತೌ ವಟಿ ಗೋದಾಯತ್ರ ನಟಿ ತರಂಗಿತ ತಟಿ ಕಲ್ಲೋಲ ಚಂಚತ್ ಪುಟಿ ದಿವ್ಯಾಮೋದ ಕುಟಿ ಭವಬ್ರಿಶಕಟಿ ಭೂತಕ್ರಿಯಾ ದುಷ್ಕುಟಿ. ಎ ಚಾರ್ಮಿಂಗ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಶಬ್ದಾಲಂಕಾರ ವಿತ್ ಮೆನಿ ರೈಮಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರೇಸಸ್. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಪಂಚವಟಿ, ದ ರಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಅಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಆಫ್ ರಾಮ, ವೇರ್ ಫೈವ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ವಟವೃಕ್ಷಾಸ್ ಅಬೌಂಡ್. ದ ಫೈವ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ವಟವೃಕ್ಷಾಸ್ ಆರ್ ಬ್ಯಾನಿಯನ್ ಟ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ಲೂಡ್ ಅಶ್ವತ್ಥ, ಪ್ಲಕ್ಷ, ನ್ಯಗ್ರೋಧ, ಬಿಲ್ವ ಅಂಡ್ ತುಳಸಿ. ಅದರ್ ವೇರಿಯಡ್ ಇಂಟರ್ಪ್ರಿಟೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್, ವಿತ್ ಅರ್ಜುನ ಟ್ರೀ ರೀಪ್ಲೇಸಿಂಗ್ ತುಳಸಿ ಫಾರ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್. ಪ್ರೊಸೀಡಿಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಶ್ಲೋಕ, ಪಾಂಥಸ್ಯೈಕ ಘಟಿ, ಎ ಕೂಲ್ ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಟ್ರಾವೆಲರ್ಸ್ ಥ್ರೂ ದ ಜಂಗಲ್ ವಿತ್ ಎ ಫಂಟಾಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ರಿವರ್ ಶೋರ್ ಲೈನ್ ಬೈ ದ ವಟವೃಕ್ಷಾಸ್, ವೇರ್ ರಿವರ್ ಗೋದಾವರಿ ಡ್ಯಾನ್ಸಸ್ ಅಲಾಂಗ್ ಹರ್ ಮಿಯಾಂಡರಿಂಗ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ಥ್ರೂ ದ ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟ್. ಗೋದಾಯತ್ರ ನಟಿ, ಹರ್ ವೇವಿ ಆರ್ಮ್ಸ್ ಹಿಟಿಂಗ್ ದ ಶೋರ್ಸ್. ತರಂಗಿತ ತಟಿ, ಕಲ್ಲೋಲ ಚಂಚತ್ ಪುಟಿ, ವಿತ್ ಅನ್ ಇಮೇಜ್ ಆಫ್ ಹರ್ ಸ್ವೀಟ್ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ಲಿಪ್ಸ್ ಮ್ಯಾನಿಫೆಸ್ಟೆಡ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಎಡ್ಜ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ವೇವ್ ಫ್ರಂಟ್. ದಿವ್ಯಾಮೋದ ಕುಟಿ, ಎ ಕಾಟೇಜ್ ಫಿಲ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಡಿವೈನ್ ಡಿಲೈಟ್. ಭವಾಪ್ತಿ ಶಕಟಿ, ಎ ಶಿಪ್ ದಟ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ಸ್ ಅಸ್ ಕ್ರಾಸ್ ದ ಓಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಲೈಫ್. ಎ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಪರ್ಜಸ್ ದ ಸಿನ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಪಾಸ್ಟ್ ಆಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್. ಭೂತಕ್ರಿಯಾ ದುಷ್ಕುಟಿ. ಬಿಲ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ದ ಅಬೌ ಡಿಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಪಂಚವಟಿ, ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಅನದರ್ ಪೋಯಮ್. ಕ್ರೀಡಾಕಲ್ಪವಟಂ ವಿಸರ್ಪಿತ ಜಟಂ ವಿಶ್ರಾಂಬುಜನ್ಮಾವಟಂ ಪಿಷ್ಟಾಂಡೌಘಟಂ ಧೃತಾಂಘ್ರಿಶಕಟಂ ಧ್ವಸ್ತಕ್ಷಮಾಸಂಕಟಂ ವಿದ್ಯುಚ್ಚಾರುರುಚಾವಿಧೂತಕಪಟಂ ಸೀತಾಧರಾಲಂಪಟಂ ಭಿನ್ನಾರೀಭಟಂ ವಿರುಘ್ನಶಕಟಂ ವಂದೇ ಗಿರಾಂ ದುರ್ಘಟಂ. ಎ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಪ್ಲೇಗ್ರೌಂಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಟ್ರೀಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್. ಒನ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ಸೇಜಸ್ ವಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ ವೇರಿಂಗ್ ಮ್ಯಾಟೆಡ್ ಲಾಕ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹೇರ್. ವಿಶ್ರಾಂಬು ಜನ್ಮಾವಟಂ, ಎ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ಟು ರಿಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್. ಪಿಷ್ಟಾಂಡೌಘ ಘಟಂ, ಎ ವಾಟರಿಂಗ್ ಹೋಲ್ ಫಾರ್ ಲಾರ್ಜ್ ಫ್ಲಾಕ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಬರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಧೃತಾಂಗ್ರಿ ಶಕಟಂ, ವೇರ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಫೀಲ್ ಸೋ ಲೈಟ್ ಹಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಅನ್ಬರ್ಡನ್ ಬೈ ವರೀಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಇಫ್ ದೇ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ವೀಲ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದರ್ ಫೀಟ್. Dvastakshama Sankatam, the place where Ravana's downfall began, thereby ridding the world of a great menace. Vidyut Charurucha Vidhuta Kapatam, a sublimely scenic spot where vice and deception seem completely out of place. Sitadhara Lampatam, a favorite place of Sita. Bhinnari Bhaghatam, a place from which wild intoxicated elephants were repelled. Vandegiram Durghatam, a place so transcendental that its description defies verbal expression. That brings us to the fourth act of Hanuman Nataka, wherein we see a wonderful description of Rama's pursuit of the golden deer. For some reason, no other poet has chosen to highlight this part of the story.
Andolayan Vishikameka Karena Sardham Kodanda Kandama Parena Karena Dhunvan Sannahya Pushpalataya Patalam Jatanam Ramo Mrugam Mrugayate Vanavithikasu.
Twirling a feathered arrow with one hand, brandishing his mighty Kodanda bow with another, using the bow to push away the tree branches that get in his way, with his locks of hair bundled and tied up with flowery vines that grow in the forest, Rama pursued the deer along the hunting trails in the jungle. At this point, Dr. Ganesh asks, how often do we see paintings of Rama depicting such a natural scene? Most artists and painters have chosen to depict Rama sitting on a majestic throne, posing for a group photo with his family and friends, not to mention household pets like a squirrel on his back. But true artistic creativity lies in identifying and bringing out greatness in ordinary actions of people, ordinary moments of life, and everyday phenomena of nature. We now jump to Sita's abduction by Ravana and Jatayu's valiant attempt in defense of Sita as she is being carried away by Ravana.
Re re phaf paradara chora kimare dhiram tvayagam yate tishtadhishtita chandana chalatata prapto jatayuswayam munchainam pati devatam nakhaluchen machanchutundankusha kruravaskaranam vranasru gurasaf pasyanti gridrastava.
Re repaf paradara chora kimare adhiram tvaya gamyate tishta adhishtita chandana chalatata prapto jatayuswayam munchainam patidevatam nakaluchet machanchu thundankusha kruravaskaranam vranasrugurasaf pasyanti ghrutrastava. Hey you scoundrel, abductor of other people's wives, where do you think you are going? Walking away with a cowardly gait of a common thief. Stand still. I, Jatayu, have entered the airspace of this sandalwood mountain summit. Chandana chala tata prapto Jatayu swayam. Release her, Sita, who is devoted to her husband. If not, the flesh and blood spilling out of your heart, gutted by my sharp beaks, would be gratefully consumed by the vultures. Moreover,
Janma Brahma Kule Hararchana Vidhau Krutva Shirah Krantanam Shaktir Vajrini Ghora Danta Dharana Vyapara Shaktam Manaha Helola Sita Keli Kantu Kanibah Kailasa Utpatitaha Tatkim Ravana Lajjase Naharase Chauryena Patnim Raghoho.
Janma Brahmakule Hararchana Vidau Krutva Shirakrantanam Shaktir Vajrini Ghora Danta Dharana Vyapara Shaktam Manaha Helola Sita Keli Kantukaniba Kailasa Utpatidaha Tatkim Ravana Nalajase Harase Chauryena Patnim Raghoho. Just look at you. You are born in the dynasty of Lord Brahma himself. You offered your own heads by way of appeasing Lord Shiva. You have withstood the onslaught of Indra's thunderbolt and the dreadful bruises inflicted by the tusks of Airavata, the celestial elephant, during battles with Devendra. Yuddhe ruddha surebhadanta kulisha vyalida vakshasthalam. It is said in Bhasa's Abhisheka Nataka. Furthermore, helollasita kelikantuka nibha kailasa utpatitaha. Once upon a time, you did casually shake the foundations of the Kailasa mountain as if it were a mere child's play. With such an impressive track record, how is it that you aren't ashamed of stealing Rama's wife through deception? Ravana sees Jatayu and wonders who this creature might be. Could this be the Mainaka mountain?
Mainakah kimayam runadhi purato manmargam avyahatam. Shaktastasya kutasya vajrapatanat bhito mahendradapi. Tarkshyasopi samam nijena vibhuna janati mam ravanam. Am jnatasya jatayuresha jarasavishto vadham vanchate.
Is this the Mainaka mountain, who has ascended from the ocean with his wings intact and flying towards me to obstruct my path? How dare he? He didn't even have the courage to stand up to Devendra, whom I have convincingly defeated in battle. No, it can't be that cowardly Mainaka. Could this be Garuda instead? No, forget him. Even his supreme master knows not to mess with me, the invincible Ravana. Oh, I get it. This is the geriatric bird Jatayu, unable to bear the ravages of old age, approaching me with a death wish. Poor old Jatayu, let me put you out of your misery. The poet describes Ravana's vanity with such flair. This is literary art in its finest form, unencumbered by blind devotion, orthodoxy or religiosity. All those aspects take a backseat while literary aesthetics reign supreme. Poetry such as this paint an impressive picture of Ravana's arrogance, and the readers experience supreme delight as Rama eventually prevails over such a monster. The resulting aesthetic enjoyment leads us to spiritual refinement and rejuvenation in much greater measure than blind devotion, ritualism, asceticism, and such other religious practices. The resulting sense of elation makes us feel larger than life and guides us intellectually and spiritually towards a quest for self-realization and ultimate liberation or moksha, a deep understanding of our oneness with the cosmos. Coming back to the story, in the next poem, Jatayu reassures Sita. This incident is not addressed in any other work.
Ma bhaishif putri sita vrajati mama puro naisha duram duratma. Re re rakshah kvadaran raghukula tilakasya pahritya prayasi. Chanchat kshepa praharat trutita dhamanibhir dikshu vikshipyamanaihi. Asha palopaharam dashabhirapi bhrusham tvachirobih karomi.
Ma bhaishif putri sita prajati mama puro naisha duram duratma. Re re raksha kvadaran raghukula tilakasya pahritya prayasi. Chanchat kshepa praharat trutita dhamanibir dikshu vikshipyamanaihi.
Asha palopaharam dashabhirapi bhrusham tvachirobih karomi.
Oh daughter Sita, don't be afraid. While I am here, this villain won't be able to take you away very far. Hey monster, where do you think you are going? Abducting her ladyship, the honorable wife of Sri Rama, himself an illustrious descendant of the Raghu clan. I shall split open the veins in your body with my sharp beak and scatter them all around. I shall feed your 10 heads to as many Dikpalakas, the divine guardians of the 10 directions. Unfortunately, poor Jatayu, who aspired for such heroism, is sadly fallen, mortally wounded by Ravana's arrows. In Valmiki Ramayana, the poet says that at the end of the battle with Ravana, Jatayu looked like a harmless bird trapped in a cage of arrows. Later, Rama comes back and realizes that Sita is gone. Rama is so distraught by the loss of his beloved wife that he is beginning to feel disoriented, as if he is losing his hold on reality. He wonders.
Bahirapinapadanam panktirantar nakachet kimidamiyama sita parnashala kimanya ahamapi kilanayam sarvatharaghavaschet kshanamapi nahi soda hanta sita viyogam.
Bahirapinapadanam panktirantar nakachet kimidamiyamasita parnashala kimanya ahamapi kilanayam sarvata raghavaschet kshanamapi nahi sodha hanta sita viyogam. Bahirapi napadanam panktihi bahirapi napadanam panktihi antarnakachit. Kimidam yamasita parnashala parnashala asita parnashala kimidam iyamasita parnashala kimanya ahamapi kilana ahamapi kilanayam sarvatha raghavaschet ahamapi kilanayam sarvatha sarvatha raghavaschet raghavah chet kshanamapi kshanamapi nahi sodha kshanamapi nahi sodha hanta hanta sita viyogam hanta sita viyogam kshanamapi kshanamapi nahi soda hanta sita viyogam.
He looks in and around the hermitage. He observes, I see Sita's footprints going out of the hermitage, but I don't see any corresponding prints tracing them back into the hermitage. This hermitage without Sita in it doesn't even seem like a hermitage at all to me. Or for that matter, I am not even sure that I am Rama anymore. Just as the hermitage seems so alien to me, so does my own body. Unless I am somebody else in Rama's body, how could I hold on to my life even for a moment when I have lost Sita? Rama cannot even imagine his own existence without Sita by his side. Could there possibly be a better way of describing Rama's sense of loss? Valmiki has described Rama's trauma and desperation upon losing Sita in a truly soul-rending manner. In fact, Bhojaraja says, Valmika garbha munireva kathora chetaha. Valmiki must have had a heart of stone, hardened by the anthills from which he arose. Or else, how could he have described such a tragic situation and still be emotionally capable of moving on to complete the rest of the story? But the poem we saw just now also adds an additional dimension beyond Valmiki's conception to Rama's tragic state of mind. Rama then discovers a shawl that belonged to Sita, which has fallen from the sky as Sita was carried off in the Pushpaka Vimana. Rama picks up the shawl or blanket and reminisces.
Dyute panah pranayakelishu kantapashah krida parishramaharam vyajanam ratante shayya nishita samaye janakatmajayah praptam maya vidhivashadidamuttariyam.
This poem is from Kundamala of Dinnaga, a fine example of Ullekhalankara. It is said that Ullekhalankara is particularly effective in depicting a sense of longing, as this poem will amply demonstrate.
Rama says, looking at the shawl, Sita would offer this piece of cloth as a wager during games of dice. I would use it to catch her by the neck while playing and having fun. After intense sporting activities, we would use it as a makeshift fan to cool ourselves. When we had a tiff and decided to sleep in separate beds, Sita would use this same blanket as her sleeping bag. By an evil twist of fate, I am now left holding on to this garment, while its owner is nowhere to be found. So the poem is an example of Ullekhalankara, so well suited to describe the sense of longing and pathos. Dr. Ganesh says that his cultural associate, Dr. Sridhar, presented this verse in a dance form so touchingly that it was appreciated by audiences the world over, transcending cultural differences. Rama continues to search for Sita frantically, but does not find her anywhere. He feels a sense of utter hopelessness, as he fears that he may never see Sita again.
Madhyoyam haribismitam himarucha netre kurangi ganaihi kantis champaka kudmalaih kalaravo haha krutakokilaihi matangair gamanam katham kathamaho hamsair vibhajyaduna kantare sakalair vinashya pashuvan nitasi bhomaitili. Madhyoyam haribihi smitam himarucha netre kurangi ganaihi kantis champaka kudmalaihi kalaravo haha kruta kokilaihi matangair gamanam katham kathamaho hamsair vibhajyaduna kantare sakalair vinashya pashuvan nitasi bho maitili. O Sita, I think this entire forest has collectively abducted you. The lions have stolen your slender waist. The moon has stolen your smile. A herd of deer has stolen your two eyes. The flowers have stolen your colorful resplendence. The cuckoo birds have stolen your voice. The great elephants and swans have stolen your majestic gait and somehow split it amongst themselves. On the whole, this entire forest has taken you away, split off your individual parts and divided them piecemeal among its various creatures. Next follows another hopelessly poignant expression by Rama.
Yuktameva hi kaikeya yadaham proshito vane idrushi yasya me buddhihi mrugah kvapi hiranmayah. Mother Kaikeyi did the right thing, denying me the kingdom and banishing me to the forest. She knew that I am such an impractical, gullible idiot. How else could I be so naive as to believe that a golden deer could ever be genuine? Kaikeyi knew that I was unfit to be a king. As mentioned elsewhere,
asambhavam hema mrugasya janma tathapi ramo lulube mrugaya.
A golden deer is an impossibility, yet Rama went on its pursuit. Similarly, in our own lives, we often pursue things that don't really exist. But in this shloka, the poet depicts how Rama is beating himself up so badly in a state of utter desperation at Sita's loss. As Rama's suffering continues, he gets even more depressed to the extent that he goes into a state of delirious confusion and amnesia, where he is unaware of his own identity, let alone his surroundings. The following shloka evokes Karuna Rasa or pathos like no other. Ke yuyam vadanatha natha kimidam dasosmite lakshmanah koham vatsasa arya eva bhagavan aryasako raghavah kim kurmo vijane jane tata ito devim samudvikshate ka devi janakadhiraja tanaya ha ha priye janaki. Rama asks Lakshmana with a blank stare, without any sense of recognition. Ke yuyam vada? Sir, who are you? Lakshmana is alarmed by Rama's behavior. He blurts out, Nathanatha? Kimidam? Dasosmite, Lakshmana. Oh, good Lord, what's happening to you? I am your servant, Lakshmana, of course. Rama asks, I see. But who am I? Koham vatsa? Lakshmana says, Oh, sir, you are our master, of course. Rama asks, Master? What does that mean? Lakshmana says,
Rama, the noble descendant of Raghu, you are our master.
Rama, is that so? But what are we doing in this desolate forest? Lakshmana answers, We are looking for the lady. Rama still doesn't have a hang of the situation. He persists, Ka Devi, who is this lady? Lakshmana replies, Janakadhiraja Tanaya, the daughter of King Janaka. Suddenly, Rama remembers, Ha ha, priye Janaki. Recognition dawns at once on Rama. How blessed is the poet who could compose a poem such as this, steeping in emotional intensity and pathos, so touching, yet not a single difficult word in the poem. Eventually,
Rama and Lakshmana encounter the dying bird Jatayu, who tells them what had happened.
What Rama says to Jatayu is a testimony to his valor and self-confidence, as well as the power of imagination of the poet.
Ta tattvam nijateja saiva gamitas svargam rajasvastite brumastve kamimam vadu hrutikatam tatantike makrutaha ramoham yaditaddinaih katipayair vridanamat kandaraha Sardham bandhu janena sendra vijayi vakta swayam ravanah.
O Sir Jatayu, you have earned your place in heaven with your immense courage and righteousness. You don't need anyone's blessing. Your inherent merit will take you right to heaven. May all be well with you. I just have a small request for you. When you meet your friend, my father Dasharatha out there, while you are shooting the breeze with him in your afterlife, please don't mention this incident about his daughter-in-law's abduction. Because, you see, I am Rama. I want my dad to hear this news not from you,
but from the mouth of Ravana himself.
Indeed, in just a short while, Ravana, having met his maker, dispatched to his afterlife, will personally confess his sins to my father. That great Ravana,
along with his supposedly invincible son Indrajit,
will soon be vanquished by me. He will approach my father with a sheepish face, with all his 10 heads hanging in shame, with all his villainous accomplices having met the same fate. He will beg for my dad's forgiveness for his unwise transgression. A perfect demonstration of Rama's self-respect and confidence, surfacing even in times of adversity and apparent hopelessness. Another fine example of poetic aesthetics, transcending religious and other parochial sentiments. Good literature is intended to just provide breathing space for aesthetic emotions, nothing more. Rama and Lakshmana continue to search for Sita, and Rama continues to lament.
Saumitre nanu sevyatam tarutalam chandam shurujrumbate chandam shor nishika katha raghupate chandro yamunmilati वत्सैतद्भवता कथन्नु विदितं धत्ते कुरंगं यथा क्वासि प्रेयसि हा कुरंगनयने चंद्रानने जानकी.
Rama says, Lakshmana, let's take shelter under a tree. The heat of the sun is just unbearable. Lakshmana replies, Oh brother Rama, how could the sun bother you now? It's night time. Look, it's the moon in the sky. Rama is unconvinced. Vatsa, etad bhavata kathannu viditam? Oh lad, how can you know for sure that this is the moon and not the sun? Lakshmana explains, Dhatte kurangam yatha. Because you can see the outline of a deer on its surface. Once he hears the word deer, Rama breaks into a reverie. Kwasi preyasi ha kuranganayane chandranane janaki. Where art thou, my dear dove-eyed moon-faced Sita? One can imagine how hard it must have been for Lakshmana to manage Rama's mood swings during that 1 year when they were looking for Sita, completely clueless as to how to find her. Lakshmana had to keep his wits about him all the time, doing all the thinking for both of them. The next poem describes Rama's reaction when he sees an Ashoka tree. This poem is from the work of Yashovarma, king of Kanyakubja, patron of art and literature, who hosted the famous poet Bhavabhuti. Yashovarma is also the author of Ramabhyudaya Nataka, which is now lost but partially reconstructed by Dr. V. Raghavan under the title Lost Place of Rama. This play of Yashovarma is highly acclaimed by many scholars of the past and is quoted by Anandavardhana in his book Dvanyaloka. This shloka appears in the context where the splendor of spring is being described around the beginning of Kishkindha Kanda. It includes some amazing poetry in Valmiki Ramayana. Valmiki says that the Ashoka tree with its fresh red leaves appears to be burning in a forest fire, with bees buzzing around its flowers looking like smoke emanating from the fire, making a crackling noise. But in reality, it is Rama's heart that is burning in the fire of his interminable grief. In this upcoming shloka from Ramabhyudaya Nataka of Yashovarma, Rama compares himself with the Ashoka tree and points out a poignant contrast.
Raktastvam navapallavairahamapi shlaghyaih priyaya gunaihi Tvamayanti shili mukha smaradhanur muktastathamamapi Kantapadatalahatistavamude tadvanmamapisthite Pyubhayostulyamashoka kevalamaham dhatrasashokah krutah O Ashoka tree, you are raktah, bright red, with your freshly sprouted leaves. I am also anurakta, deeply passionate about the virtuous qualities of my beloved. You are stung by shilimukhaha, the bees. I am also stung by shilimukhaha, stone-tipped arrows of love beyond reach, emanating from the bow of Manmatha. While Manmatha's arrows are traditionally described as made of flowers like lotus and so on, because my love is beyond reach, they feel as harsh as stones. You rejoice being kicked by lovely damsels. Kantapadatalahatistavamude. Legend has it that Ashoka trees grow well in response to being kicked by young women. In the same manner, I, Rama, also enjoy the playful strokes of my beloved's legs. Even though we are so much alike, Lord Brahma destined you to be Ashoka, one without sorrow, but doomed me to be Sashoka, full of sorrow. In the next poem, we encounter Rama's words addressing Sita, who is far removed from him.
Haro naropitah kante maya vishlesha bhiruna. Idani mantare jata parvata sarito drumaha. O Sita, in the past, I would avoid wearing flower garlands around my neck so that it may not get in the way of our intimate embrace. But alas, now mountains, rivers and forests all stand between me and you. An illustration of Vishamalankara, or figure of speech of contrast. Later on, Vanaras present to Rama Sita's ornaments that were dropped by her while she was being abducted. Rama is trying to determine if they are indeed Sita's ornaments. But he says, Janakya eva janami bhushanani iti nanyatha vatsa lakshmana janishe pashyat tvamapi tatvatah. I have not seen ornaments on any woman other than Sita. Therefore, I am unable to determine if these belong to Sita or someone else. In the language of machine learning, since I only have a sample size of one, my empirical experience lacks the ability to generalize. I cannot solve the binary hypothesis problem as to whether this jewelry belongs to Sita or someone else. So, O Lakshmana, why don't you also take a look and tell us what you think? But Lakshmana has problems of his own in ascertaining whether the ornaments belong to Janaki. Naham janami keyure, naham janami kundale, nupure tvabhi janami nityam padabhi vandanat. I cannot recognize the armband, nor can I recognize the earrings. I can only recognize the finger rings on her feet as I would see them while offering my daily salutations at her feet. I can't identify the rest of the ornaments, for I have never looked at Sita above the level of her feet. And the next poem is also from Ramabhyudaya Nataka of King Poet Yashovarma. Yatvannetra samana kanti salile magnam tadindivaram.
Yatvannetra samana kanti salile magnam tadindivaram. Meghaih antaritah priye tava mukhachaya nukari shashi ye pitvat gamana nukari gataya gaga te rajaham sagataka tvatsa drishya vinodamatram apime daive nanakshamyate yatvannetra samana kanti salile magnam tvannetra samana kanti tvannetra samana kanti salile magnam tadindivaram megai antaritah priye tava mukhachaya anukari megaihi antaritah priye tava mukhachaya anukari shashi yepi tvadgamana anukari gatayaha tvadgamana anukari gatayaha te rajaham sagataha te rajaham sagataha tvatsadrishya vinodam tvatsadrishya vinodamatram api me daivena nakshamyate daivena nakshamyate daivena nakshamyate.
In Prasravana cave of the Malyavan mountain ranges, Rama is waiting out the rainy season, after which Sugriva was to help him search for Sita. At this point, Rama has helped Sugriva regain his kingdom, and it is now up to Sugriva to honor his end of the deal. Rama is now in a helpless state, painfully waiting for the rainy season to end and for Sugriva to look favorably upon him. All he can do in the meanwhile is watch Netflix and binge perhaps on the episodes of Game of Thrones. As Valmiki describes, Sugrivasya nadinancha prasada manupalayan. He is at the mercy of two unpredictable elements, the weather and a fickle politician Sugriva, a new king of untested credibility. In the rainy season, he feels a particularly strong sense of longing for Sita. Yatvannetra samana kanti salile magnam tadindivaram. O Sita, I would like to at least look at the water lilies that remind me of your eyes, but the ponds are full and the lilies are submerged under water. Meghairantaritah priye tavamukat chayanukari shashi. I would like to look at the moon that vaguely reminds me of your face, but the moon is obscured by the clouds hanging on in the sky. Meghairantaritah priye tavamukat chayanukari shashi. If I try to look for the royal swans, whose walk is a tad bit similar to your graceful gait, the swans have also migrated away to the northern Manasasarovara region. Tvatsadrushya vinoda matram api me daivena nakshamyate. The cruel fate not only does not want me to see you, it doesn't even want me to see anything that resembles you in the slightest. This goes along somewhat similar lines to a poem in Kalidasa's Meghaduta, where a yaksha, longing for his beloved, says, Hantai tasmin api na sahate sangamanno krutanta. In that story, the yaksha tries to draw a picture of his beloved so that he can at least see her image. But then his eyes tear up, making it impossible to see even that picture. At that point, the yaksha expresses a similar sentiment that fate is indeed out to get him in every way conceivable.
Tvamalikhya pranaya kupitam daturagai shilayam atmanante charanapaditam yavadichhami kartum asraistavan muhurupachitair drushtiralubhyate me hantai tasmin api na sahate sangamanno krutantah.
This would be a good place to conclude this second installment of our Hanuman Nataka lecture series. In the next lecture, we will enter the Sundara Khanda section of the story, wherein Hanuman crosses over the mighty ocean, reaches Lanka, and looks for Sita. Until then,
Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha, sarve santu niramayaha. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kaschid dukkha bhag bhavet.
Sarve bhavantu sukhinah. Sarve santu niramaya. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu ma kaschid dukha bhag bhavet. Om shanti shanti shanti.
Shanti, shanti, shanti. Hah.
हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ
अखण्डमण्डलाकारं व्याप्तं येन चराचरं तत्पदं दर्शितं येन तत्पदं दर्शितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः स्वस्ति प्रजाभ्यः परिपालयन्तां न्याय्येन मार्गेण महीं महीषाः गोब्राह्मणेभ्यः शुभमस्तु नित्यं लोकाः समस्ताः सुखिनो भवन्तु।